Hey everyone, I'm Dan Furman, a distinguished engineer and serverless advocate here at Capital One.
And I'm Sushma, Onkar, also a distinguished engineer here at Capital One, where my attention is primarily on serverless applications. If like us, you use Python to develop serverless functions, you might appreciate the simplicity and scalability. We do. But how are you guaranteeing the health of your serverless functions?
Through observability by design. Observable apps allow you to understand the state of your system, from what's working to what's not, so you can determine what actions you need to take. That's obviously important. But what tends to happen is that we think about observability a little bit late in the development process. You want to start thinking about observability when you first develop your application. You should design observability from the ground up.
To be observable, instrument your code to be observable. You need to understand what's happening inside your functions. Observability is especially helpful when something goes wrong and you need to debug your code. This means instrumenting your code to send signals like logs, traces, and metrics to get a better picture of what your code is doing and how it's performing.
Let's start with logging and how you can use it to build better apps. Logs record events. Set up your functions to always log your code at the info level. This means two things. One, how things are working. And two, what works, or how did you have to do that? When designing for information, allow the log level to be changed without requiring a new deployment. This will ensure that all of the information needed to troubleshoot an issue is captured in the logs using that familiar log level filter.
Next, structure your logs. JSON is really nice for this. JSON can be natively interpreted, meaning it is searchable. And what is searchable is observable. You can dive through it, and you can get very fast search speeds. Plus, you can always send it downstream to an aggregator as opposed to unstructured data where somebody will have to parse and put compute power behind it.
Set a retention period for your logs. This can be expensive. Often, we hear people question if observability is worth it. You're charged by the gigabyte month, and you may want to offload it to S3 to make that more affordable. Because of long-running hard drives, retention periods are one of those things we can overlook. But we probably don't need data that's a decade old. If you do, you probably have a really defined reason for it, and you'll want to make sure you have a plan for retaining that data. Also remember, when setting a retention period, make sure you align with regulations, from government guidelines to your own organizations.
This is important. Query and visualize your logs, something you'll hear a lot. Instead of developing a custom parser, use a tool like CloudWatch Logs Insights to query and visualize your logs. This will help you quickly identify problems and resolve them faster.
Let's discuss metrics. Custom metrics are absolutely vital to most of these applications, and emit your custom metrics asynchronously. You can do this inside AWS using embedded metrics format, or EMF. Work with that data, and you can build really business-centric dashboards in code.
That said, there are different types of Lambda metrics. You need to understand them and the statistics that should be used with each. If I'm looking at the average response time for my serverless application, well, I don't want a simple average. I want to know what the customer impact was. This means I need long tails, which brings us to metric math.
Metric math functions are available to you. You can do all kinds of different functions on this. You can pull the statistical anomalies, and you can pull the correct data. You can do this by actually running through information through EMF and then letting it be aggregated immediately as soon as it's exhausted.
By the way, having a foundational understanding of statistics gives you an advantage to understand metrics and make meaning out of the numbers. If you haven't taken a statistics course and you have the opportunity, do it.
Sushma touched on this briefly, but it needs to be emphasized. Don't just look at the average. It's a good tool to know where you are, but look at P90, P95, look at P99. When it comes to response times, when it comes to error rates, and when it comes to high-end latencies, this is what impacts your customer, and this is where their experience comes from. If you have something that's responding in 100 milliseconds at the average, but P99 is 4.5 seconds, that's a really inconsistent customer experience. Sometimes your app is faster than humans can perceive. Say that's around 250 milliseconds. But if you have dependencies that move off of that and take us seconds to load the page with useful content, well, that's a long time for an API call to come back and update the page with useful information. we can do better.
So let's talk tracing. Traces are representations of your logs. They track the end-to-end behavior, providing insight into how applications are interacting with each other.
Imagine a stack trace of thousands of lines of data tracing across a bunch of different things, into packages and out of packages. It may be useful at one level of code, but it's probably less useful at others. So log what you need to allow for debugging. What do I mean by that? You want to be able to analyze what your application is doing, where it is, how it's running, but you don't want to log more information than really is needed. Why? Well, it makes the logs a little harder to search.
And of course, monitor your Lambda functions for errors and performance issues. By doing so, you can prevent problems from occurring in the first place or quickly mitigate them when they do occur. This may include automated rollback to a previous version of the Lambda function.
And for those of you in the AWS community, use AWS Lambda Powertools for Python if you aren't already. This is a fantastic open source project published on PyPI. What's great about Powertools is that it allows for simpler observability practice without you needing to build and maintain your own. But even if you aren't using AWS as your provider, you can access these tools. Powertools brings together open source libraries and together implements the AWS best practices. These tools are standard to the industry, and you likely want to use them in really any project.
We strongly recommend that you adopt Observability-Driven Development as a preferred methodology. You are likely familiar with TDD and BDD, but consider the value of ODD. In this approach, you shift left observability to be part of how you design your applications. Give yourself the ability to monitor how your app behaves in real time and proactively identify potential problems.
Observability by design is definitely doable, and the benefits are worth the effort. We all know that time is your most scarce resource. Developing and operating serverless applications to be observable can be a great way to save time and add more value to projects without compromising quality or functionality. We hope these tips we've shared will give you confidence in the health of your functions while allowing you to deliver faster.
For more advice for Python developers on serverless strategies like developing APIs in AWS SAM and optimizing file processing apps, check out our blog.
Thanks for watching.